Do you remember me, Glen?
Oh, of course I remember you, Tom.
Right on. I wasn't sure if you did. So how much time do you have with me?
Just a couple of minutes.
Okay, I'll try and be quick as possible then. How are you making out with these COVID restrictions?
Like most Canadians, it's unfortunate that we're into this pandemic situation, and I wish the Liberals would have done a better job of dealing with the things we suggested they deal with back last March, and February and March, and we wouldn't be in the mess that we're in today had they hadn't failed us so miserably.
I guess we could talk about that for quite a long time if that was the subject, but I wanted to ask you about understanding and maybe advocating for me when it comes to Bill C-10. What's your shortest description of Bill C-10?
Well, Bill C-10 originally was, presented some time ago, was to try and level the playing field, if you will, between... large foreign streaming services and Canadian broadcasters, and that was one idea of it. The other idea was is that if the big boys like Google and Facebook and all those other companies are, making money off Canadians and advertising here in Canada, then they should pay Canadian tax. And no one ever, those are laudable things. Those are great things. And then, unfortunately, what happened is the Liberals tried to inject some things that have serious consequences to individual rights and freedoms of Canadians and broadcasters. And so, it's turned into what was originally intended to be something that, appeared to have merit. Now it's an attempt by the Liberals again to target the freedoms of individual internet users in Canada. It's unacceptable, completely unacceptable. I mean, the legislation gives sweeping power to the CRTC to regulate the internet, basically including users, individual users, with no clear guidelines on how that power should be used.
If you could speak to control of the internet, would you ever allow anything like SOPA to run through Canada?
No, I think SOPA is a step in the wrong direction. We need to look at net neutrality, we need to look at open data, we need to look at understanding the need to link consumers of information and culture on the internet more directly to creators of content and culture on the internet in a way that both allows access for consumers but protects the creativity and the livelihoods of the creators. And for that we don't need middlemen and we don't need overarching structures like the American lobbyists are putting forward.
They voted against their own bill that would have at least partially exempted individual users who upload videos to social media sites like YouTube and Facebook from CRT regulation. So, it's silly. I don't know what they thought they were doing or what they thought they could get away with to try and do this. We proposed, the Conservatives proposed to protect individual users and small players in the market by exempting streaming services and social media users with lower revenues, and the Liberals rejected this. I thought was a very common sense compromise, and they rejected it outright.
How far along is this bill?
It is. It's at committee right now, so it's gone through second reading, and it's at committee for amendments at the moment.
Is the CRTC, that regulatory body, are they modern enough to deal with issues like Facebook and YouTube broadcasters?
I would not be the right person to ask that question. But okay. Anytime they are the they are the regulator, if you will, right? Canadian Radio, Television, and Telecommunications Commission. They're the kind of the regulator for Canadian content is one aspect of what their responsibilities are. But anytime that you have a government regulatory body that regulates content, who's to say that, why are we regulating that sort of content? And who's to say, why is government then interfering in this? Like, there's no clear proof that the Liberals are targeting ordinary Canadians in this process, and it's unacceptable. Like, what our society values, its freedoms. And this is just an out and out infringement upon freedom of speech. And we will, as conservatives, we have stood up against this from the word as soon as it became apparent what the Liberals were trying to do, and we'll continue to stand up for the freedoms of Canadians, who want to post their content online. And we are opposing this every stage of the way, Thomas.
This brings me, obviously, to my next point. I'll try and be as quick as possible. So there's this guy here in Walsh, Alberta, Anwar Cameron. He ran for the Liberals in Alberta in 2019. He was recently arrested on assault charges, threats, breaching orders. He's being held without bail until his trial on July 12th. Since being locked up, a few victims contacted me from northern Iraq, and one in Canada, a man Anwar brought here to work and then allegedly threatened to kill him. And if he talked to the authorities about Anwar's past or his criminal behavior. This has uncovered an alleged immigration fraud scheme in which Anwar used his Liberal Party ties, like photos of himself with former Liberal David Kahn, to allegedly dupe 18 families in northern Iraq for over $300,000 Canadian. Complaints involving death threats date back to 2017, among other alleged offenses, and he was known in the courts in BC in 2004, 2005, and 2012. Would you consider asking Mr. Speaker how it's possible that Anwar Cameron was allowed to run for the Alberta Liberals, and what kind of background checks are being done, and how does the Liberal Party prevent candidates from using their ties to the party to defraud people in another country? The Liberal Party never contacted me back, so I was hoping you could maybe help out with this in the interest of public safety, maybe.
Well, first of all, you're conflating provincial with federal. He ran for the Alberta Liberals.
Alberta Liberals, yeah. Sorry if I misspoke there.
Not the federal Liberals.
Yes. Sorry if I misspoke there.
So it would be most inappropriate for me to have any comment on this. At the federal level.
Gotcha.
I will also go on to say that if there are allegations against this individual that are criminal in nature, I would hope that those who have this information and these concerns, who have brought them to the authorities' attention, and I'm confident that an investigation will be done with respect to any criminal allegations or as you suggested, potentially immigration fraud that may have transpired. And as far as anything to do with the Alberta Liberal Party and however they do their candidate selections, that'll be a comment that they'll have to get back to you on. I have nothing to add for that.
Totally understand. Fair. Very fair. I appreciate what you have to say about the potential victims here. And I know they've been sort of fighting for a while, and the communication barriers of being in a country like Iraq and the resources that they have there are so limited that it's taken a while for anybody to get through to somebody in Canada. And I'm hoping that there's some way that we might be able to stay in touch off and on about this and see if there's any way that you can advocate for them, because they had issues when first encountering police. He sought immigration in 2017, and I guess they're still working on the case. So, having been 5 years of them working on a case where a guy was, potentially almost human trafficked, brought over from Iraq, forced to work, threatened to be killed, I think it's a big story, and I hope that if we could stay in touch, that it's something that you might be able to help advocate for those families.
Well, if there's any veracity to the allegations that have been made, I am confident that going to the right authorities by this individual who has been the victim of this, we'll get some resolution.
Gotcha. So being that I'm the guy that can sort of dig up these things and, I don't know, maybe you like the story even, I'm hoping that you'll advocate for me, the little guy, when it comes to Bill C-10. If you keep me in mind, that guy, remember when we met out in a cow field in, I think it was somewhere in Walsh with Rona Ambrose.
And thank you very much for gathering today and for welcoming Ron and myself. We're excited that you could be here, and one of the things we wanted to do, unlike what the Liberals did when they brought Trudeau here, not just to have a photo op. This is about meeting people and listening to their issues and caring about the people of this riding, so we can take those issues back to Ottawa and we can properly address them with government.
That little guy who's been an independent here in Medicine Hat for a long time, working hard, I hope that you'll think about me when you're making these amendments to Bill C-10 or suggesting amendments to Bill C-10.
Yeah, we're thinking of all Canadians when it comes to freedom of all Canadians is at stake here with freedom of speech. So we will certainly advocate for you and everyone who finds themselves with, having some censorship when it comes to online content and what they choose to post themselves. That's taking a step too far.
Thanks so much for helping me out, Glenn. Anything else? You take care, too.
Okay, bye-bye.
Bye-bye. Folks, thanks for watching Community TV. If you like my content, I want you to support me by supporting the local community sponsors. These are local businesses owned by local people, and I want to give a few shout-outs. First off, Mucho Burrito. We just celebrated Cinco de Mayo, and it's summer now, and I think one of the best summer foods is a burrito. If you agree with me, head over to Mucho Burrito. They're one of the sponsors this month. Also, Gold Dust Jewelry. You know, Johan. He used to have a retail store, but he's shut that down, and now he's doing everything over the internet. So reach out to him on his Facebook page, Gold Dust Jewelry, if you've got a repair that needs done, or you want to design something brand new. He's got access to a whole bunch, like an archive of 3D printed things that you could print 3D, gold, silver, whatever you want. Hemptown Rock. Patty at Hemptown Rock has been a sponsor for over a decade. She does brilliant things at her store down there on Railway in downtown Medicine Hat, right next to the Assiniboine. And she's got everything you need if it comes to cannabis consumption or cannabis advice. I know a lot of these new cannabis stores, they're not really allowed to provide any medical advice because their products are all just recreational. So if you've got some new cannabis product or you're doing it for the first time, or you just maybe need some new advice on different types of consumption, maybe you're doing edibles for the first time or making oils, a magic butter machine, go see Patty, Hemptown Rock. She's the lady to talk to when it comes to learning and understanding cannabis in our community. Also want to mention Truckers. They're on the highway. You know Truckers 24/7. If you've been in our community, you have ordered Truckers late at night, or maybe even just gone up there at 3 o'clock in the morning. It's a great place. Like, if you haven't tried it yet, you got to try it. They're available on all of the apps out there, or you could just give them a call directly, which I recommend these days. Save you some money and probably save the restaurant some money. So call directly, order something from Truckers. They're available until late at night. I think there's still restrictions, but when the restrictions are lifted, they're back to 24/7, and that's something that Medicine Hat always needs, is a 24/7 Mac burger. Animal World. Rob over at Animal World, thanks so much, Rob. You're the expert that I look to when I have any questions about pond-related stuff, even like minor like plumbing things. You seem to know everything there is to know about how pumps work and how water moves around and how those koi fish move around in that water. And you're a brilliant guy, Rob at Animal World. If you don't know him and you're a pet enthusiast or animal enthusiast of any kind, you have to go meet Rob at Animal World. Thanks so much to those sponsors. I will also mention Spider Farmer LED lights. Gonna be recording a video for them actually today, later on today, recording a video. They've sent me their SF4000 model. It's a big LED grow light. I mean, it's super powerful, so it's gonna be totally awesome. And I recommend that if you're gonna be growing some plants indoors, get Spider Farmer. It's on Amazon, easy to order, I'll put the links in the comment section so that you could find them. It's the best bang for your buck. They use a diode called the Samsung LM301B, and that's technical nerd jargon, but what it means is that the little thingy where the light comes out, it just puts out the right kind of light. It mimics the sunlight. You know how when you turn on, you got the cool white, you got the warm bulbs, you got the, all the different spectrums of bulbs? Well, this is like perfect replication of the sun in Jamaica. So you need to get a Spider Farmer LED light. Like I said, the best bang for your buck. Don't go on Amazon and spend, you know, $79.99 on some piece of garbage, end up getting something that's like a wish light. It's actually this big when you thought it was this big. But I recommend for your four plants, start with the SF2000. But you know, it goes up from there. They got a model called the SF7000, and I hope I can get one of those. Thanks, Spider Farmer. You're the best.